बुद्धुपादो दुर्लभो 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 लोकस्मिन् मनुष्य भाव दुर्लभो दुर्लभो दुर्लभं सद्धं सवनं दुर्लभ सद्ध संपत्ति पब्बचित भाव दुर्लभो।
From time immemorial, the world has witnessed many Buddhas, the perfectly enlightened ones. Every Buddha rediscovers and teaches Dhamma, the law of nature. The truth that gives deliverance from suffering. Noble teachings of a Buddha benefit millions. Yet, after a Buddha departs, the teachings start to get converted into traditions, literature, and slowly the core gets lost in the flow of time. What gets left behind is the empty shells of mere words. Many eons ago, blessed by one such Buddha, Deepankar, a hermit named Sumedh took a vow to make all the necessary preparations to become a Buddha. Existence after existence, the Bodhisattva Sumedh accumulated mental energies and purity of the highest order till he took birth as Siddharth Gautama in 624 BC. After ardent efforts of 6 years, at the age of 35, Siddharth Gautama attained supreme enlightenment on the eve of the full moon day of Vaishakha. Having attained Buddhahood, Gautama the Buddha traveled throughout northern India to compassionately teach people to walk on the path of Dhamma. He exhorted his fully liberated disciples to spread it across India. Over 2 centuries after the Buddha, Emperor Ashoka was horrified by the bloodshed and sorrow of the Kalinga War that he had waged. Once introduced to Vipassana, he solemnly resolved to follow the path of Dhamma. The fierce Ashoka was transformed into Dhamma Ashoka. He facilitated the journey of fully liberated monks to 9 different regions of the world to make Dhamma available to all mankind. Post Ashoka, the practice and theory of Vipassana, the core of Buddha's teaching, started to deteriorate gradually, and over the centuries, it was totally lost in India, to the extent that even the word Vipassana went out of circulation. With the passage of time, most other countries too lost the technique of Vipassana. The world was plunged into the darkness of ignorance. In the midst of this darkness, only one country preserved this technique in its pristine purity, Myanmar.
केवल ये देश स्वर्ण भूमि है, सोना है, वो रत्न को संभाल के रखेगा, 2500 वर्ष तक संभाल के रखेगा। और फिर भविष्यवाणी की कि 2500 वर्ष के बाद जब भारत में इसका नामो निशान नहीं होगा, तब ये बर्मा से भारत आएगा। भारत में अनेक लोग इसे स्वीकार करेंगे और तब ये विश्व में फैलेगा।
इन म्यांमार Vipassana was kept in its pure form by a lineage of dedicated monks for several generations till today. One such teacher in this chain was Lady Sayalu, a visionary monk who thoughtfully and boldly opened the doors of Vipassana technique to lay people.
Lady Sayalu was a big scholar. He was a master of Pali language. He wrote many books, many commentaries, many poems. He was a good poet, and then he became master of both. theory and practice, pariyati and patipati. He realized that now 2500 years is coming. The Dhamma has to spread round the world, and it will spread round the world if the householders take up this vision. Because people will have more confidence in them, one thing, and people will feel more non-sectarian in taking Dhamma from them. And people will feel that this path is not merely for monks. So then he was the first person who decided that there must be householder teachers. And he gave teaching to a few householders.
Sayathetji was one of the early lay students. Born in a poor family in 1873, he lost his father at the age of 10. He braved abject poverty with hard work, great integrity and spiritual strength, and went on to become a well-regarded, prosperous member of the community. The untimely death of his children and relatives in a cholera epidemic prompted his fervent search for deathlessness. It brought him to Lady Sayadaw, who taught him Vipassana. In due course of time, Lady Sayadaw appointed him as the first lay teacher of Vipassana, recognizing his exceptional qualities and abundant paramis.
Initially, difficulty was there. First, he gathered a few of his own laborers in the farm and told them that what daily wages you get, I'll give you your daily wages. And they made it. They got result. And the word started spreading. Well, there is something with this cultivator. People got attracted. More and more people started coming. And this is how it spread.
With the support of his wife and other relatives to look after his material needs, Sayathetji had ample time to introduce Dhamma to hundreds of householders and monks. This was a major milestone in the modern journey of Dhamma. One of his most promising students was Uba Khin, a senior government official renowned for his integrity and efficiency. In 1941, Sayaji Uba Khin met Venerable Vibhu Sayadaw, a monk who dwelt in seclusion and was believed to be an enlightened arhat. Seeing Sayaji Uba Khin's astonishing progress in Vipassana, Vibhu Sayadaw advised him to immediately start teaching. Obeying him on that very day, he taught Anapan meditation to a station master at the nearby Chowski railway station in a railway carriage. In 1952, Sayaji founded International Meditation Center at Yangon, where he taught Vipassana to thousands of Burmese and foreign students. Sayaji Uba Khin had immense love and gratitude towards India. In one corner of his center, there was a model of the lofty peaks of Himalayas. He would meditate beside it every day, sending his goodwill to India and wishing for Dhamma to return to its land of origin.
उनके मन में इस बात की बहुत धर्म कामना कि किस तरह से भारत का हम पर ऋण है. भारत ने इतनी बड़ी संपदा, धर्म की संपदा हमें दी, इतना अनमोल रत्न हमें दिया. आज भारत कंगाल है, उसके पास नहीं है. ये विद्या नष्ट हो गई, बुद्ध की शिक्षा नष्ट हो गई. हमको ये कर्जा चुकाना है. एक ही बात बार बार कहते थे, हमें भारत का कर्जा चुकाना है. ये अनमोल रत्न जो भारत से आया वो भारत में वापस जाए. द्वितीय बुद्ध शासन जागेगा, दूसरी बार बुद्ध का धर्म जोरों से जागेगा, ऐसी मान्यता है. तो इन थोड़े से आचार्यों ने ये विपश्यना की शिक्षा लुप्त ना हो जाए, भारत में लुप्त हो गई, बाकी देशों में लुप्त हो गई, हमारे यहाँ लुप्त ना हो जाए, इसलिए संभाल कर रखी कि 2500 वर्ष के बाद ये विद्या भारत जानी है, बुद्ध की शिक्षा सारी भारत जानी है. तो हम उसको शुद्ध नहीं रखेंगे तो जाएगी कैसे, और जाएगी तो शुद्ध रूप में कैसे जाएगी. बहुत संभाल के रखा.
दिस डॉक्यूमेंट्री कैप्चर्स द जर्नी ऑफ प्योर धम्मा, द मोस्ट प्रेशियस जेम फॉर मैनकाइंड. From one small country that preserved it carefully to the rest of the world, it is a story of its renewed availability and spread. द राइज ऑफ धम्मा
एकायनौ वयं भिक्खवे मग्गु सत्तानं विशुद्धिय शोक परिदेवानं समतिक्कमाय दुःखदो मनस्सानं अत्थंगमाय न्यायस्स अधिगमाय निब्बानस्स सच्चिकिरियाय यदिदं चत्तारु सतिपट्ठानाति।
The earnest wish of Sayaji Uba Khin bore fruit when an exemplary instrument of Dhamma, S.N. Goenka, was born in 1924 in Mandalay, Myanmar. Goenkaji's life was full of twists and turns, it would appear Dhamma had planned. He was deeply influenced by his pious and poetic grandfather, who instilled devotion, fondness for poetry, and love for the motherland in Goenkaji. Though born in a staunch Hindu family, he grew fond of silent contemplation with his grandfather in Mandalay's famous Mahamyamuni Pagoda, kindling in him a spiritual quest at a young age.
Guruji vipashta karne ke pehle to bahut Krishna bhakt the aur Babulal aur dono bhai itne bhajan gaya karte the bahut bhajan gaya karte the।
Rahiman Sudha, a book gifted by his school teacher Dubey ji, inspired him to write his first doha at the tender age of 8 years. Dedicated to his grandfather, these first dohas were the beginning of the hundreds of inspiring couplets that he wrote in Hindi and Rajasthani languages throughout his life.
Itna padhne ka shauk tha to bachpan mein jaise unke lekh wagaira mein bhi honge bahut jagah ki स्कूल के टाइम पर कैसे कितने लेख लिखे कितने प्रवचन उस वक्त ही देने लग गए छोटे में। उनका एक रूम पूरा इतनी बड़ी लाइब्रेरी थी, पूरी लाइब्रेरी से भरी पड़ी थी, इतनी स्टडी करते थे।
As Goenkaji grew older, his leadership qualities, generosity and commitment to social reforms became evident. In spite of securing a gold medal in matriculation and keenness to get to a college, he dutifully obeyed his family and entered business, soon impressing all with his extraordinary flair for it. Undaunted by the disturbance and exile caused by the Japanese attack on Myanmar, Goenkaji continued to excel in business. On the sidelines, he showed unwavering commitment to social causes and was chosen a leader of the Indian community and several other organizations. However, wealth and prominence brought along the experience of the first noble truth, Dukkha.
As I grew, at a very young age, I was successful in business, successful in society. So, a lot of tension because of ego. Well, I am now such a successful person. And the migraine started coming with more frequency. Every 15 days, there's the attack, and very severe attack.
In 1954, while serving as a member of the food committee in the 6th Dhamma Sanghayana, Goenkaji indirectly came in contact with Dhamma. A year later, a suggestion by his close friend that Vipassana could be a cure for his migraine, a psychosomatic disorder, brought Goenkaji to Sayaji Uba Khin.
So I went to my teacher, Sayaji Uba Khin, discussed with him, and I told him I have come because U Chantun has sent me to you to get rid of migraine. He said, no, I won't take you. Go to some doctor. This is not the hospital. And then very compassionately explains to me that you are devaluing Dhamma. Look, the Dhamma is to make you liberated from all sorts of misery, not just this migraine. Coming out of migraine is a very small thing for the technique for which you will be taught. This is a byproduct only. once you get this technique properly practiced, migraine will go away. But don't come with the aim of curing your migraine. I said, all right, I won't come for migraine. Forget migraine. But if you can give me a technique which will purify my mind, certainly I will come. And I went there.
Goenkaji attended his first Vipassana course between September 1 and 11, 1955 at the International Meditation Center and underwent a life-changing transformation. He almost abandoned the course on the very first day but progressed so dramatically thereafter that Sayaji had to take his special care.
Course was at international meditation by the time the center was established, and there was one room or two rooms with attached bathroom, proper rooms, but my Sayaji gave me a room. It was just four pieces of plywood, no window, the one door was only this plywood, and hardly 5 feet. When I sleep, I cannot spread my leg properly, and in front of it a row of latrines. I thought, well, there is a good room there. It is vacant. Some important VIPs might be coming. That's why Guruji is not giving me that place all night. One day, 2 days, nobody is coming. 3 days, nobody is coming. I stay there. Later on, he told me, I want to crush your ego. So I gave you that. You are a leader of the Indian community here. You are a leader of the business people. You have got so much of ego in your mind. You must work there. And if you can work there, you will be successful. And I was successful. So that was the first course at the International Meditation Center that I got.
For the next 10 years, Goenkaji regularly meditated and served at the IMC. In 1964, due to the nationalization of private business in Myanmar, he suffered huge losses. Ignoring the seemingly material misfortune, he immersed himself in the study of the teachings of the Enlightened One under the guidance of his teacher. With this combination of pariyatti and patipatti, theory and practice, Goenkaji achieved profound understanding of Dhamma. Unknown to Goenkaji, Sayaji was training him to fulfill his destiny of being a torchbearer of Dhamma, to spread Vipassana first in India and then all around the world.
My first training was to give Anapana and to give Vipassana. Then suddenly Sayaji says that, Goenka, why we give courses only here in Rangoon? I would like to give course in up country somewhere. Can you arrange? Yes, sir, we can arrange. So a course was given in Mandi. Evening discourse, Sayaji makes me, there's a cot there, sleeping cot, and that becomes our Dhamma seat. Sayaji sitting and I myself sitting. In the evening, Sayaji said, now you give the Dhamma talk. You can speak, all right, you speak. After 10, 15 minutes again, he will prompt me. Now Vishakha, and I have to speak something about Vishakha. Now Anathpindak, I have to speak something. 1 day, 2 days, 3 days, and then it went. He was planning that I have to take gypsy camps in future. So I must be well trained for gypsy camps, not just giving courses in the center. So one in Mandalay, one in Memeo. So that was a good preparation he made for me. And then of course when I came there, I remember, oh, that is why Sayaji took me to all these places, to train me to give gypsy camps.
As the time ripened, an opportunity presented itself, and Goenkaji got a visa to travel to India to teach Vipassana to his ailing mother. On June 20, 1969, Sayaji formally authorized Goenkaji to teach Vipassana on his behalf. Before they parted, Sayaji assured him, "You are not the one going, I am going. Dhamma is going." The prophecy, based on which this liberating technique of Vipassana was preserved with great care for 2,500 years, was about to come true. Once again, the Ganges of pure Dhamma was ready to flow throughout the world for the benefit of many, for the welfare of many. June 22, 1969, Goenkaji landed in Kolkata, India, and that very day, tremors were experienced in eastern India. As predicted by Sayaji, nature expressed his joy on the return of Vipassana to the land of his birth after a gap of nearly 2 millennia, symbolized by the moment Goenkaji put his foot down at the Kolkata airport. In spite of these early signals and the assurance of his teacher, Goenkaji's mind had lurking doubts.
तो जब आया तो पहली कठिनाई तो ये हुई कि कौन मेरा साथ देगा? ये तो गृहस्थ है, धोती कुर्ता पहनने वाला, ये क्या देगा हमें? कौन है हमारे पास? और वो भी आए 10 दिन के लिए, 10 दिन के लिए घर बार छोड़ के हमारे पास कौन रहेगा? और रहे भी तो कौन व्यवस्था करेगा? कहाँ 10 दिन का हम शिविर लगाएंगे? हमारे मन में आया कि यह भविष्यवाणी फालतू है, कभी होने वाली है। 15 दिन नहीं बीते कि विपश्यना का शिविर लग गया, कोई आगे खड़ा हो गया व्यवस्था करने के लिए, सारा प्रबंध करने के लिए। अरे विश्वास नहीं होता था, आ गया। फिर उसमें हमारी माता बैठी, हमारे पिता बैठे, बड़ा मन प्रसन्न हुआ।
Between July 3 to 13, 1969, the first Vipassana course was completed in Panchayati Wadi, Mumbai, nearly 2 millennia after the last course in India. Soon after, the second course was organized in Madras. Slowly, the word started to spread. The students who benefited from these initial courses enthusiastically came forward to arrange more courses. The wheel of Dhamma had started to rotate. After every course, Goenkaji used to send a report to his teacher, seeking his guidance. Sayaji Ubakhin used to feel a lot of satisfaction at his students' achievements. Sayaji Ubakhin passed away on January 19, 1971. It was while conducting a course in Bodh Gaya that the news of his demise reached Goenkaji. After deep contemplation, Goenkaji decided to drop all other worldly responsibilities and to fully devote the rest of his life to fulfill the most cherished wish of his Dhamma father. Goenkaji shared this thought with his family and received their wholehearted support and an assurance to take care of his needs. In September 1971, his wife, Ilaichi Devi Goenka, also joined him from Myanmar. Her quiet presence by Goenkaji's side encouraged a greater number of ladies to join courses. Goenkaji started to conduct the courses through the length and breadth of India. These initial courses at rented sites, at schools, temples, guest houses, hotels and mosques, they were full of hardships and trials.
Yeah, our first course, I registered, filled out the application form, and they said, okay, this is your room. Somebody took me up and showed me, and it was a room about half the size of this room, just a floor like this, a stone floor, no mattresses, no pillows, and in the hall it was the same, no sitting cushions. So whatever you had with you, that was what you slept on, that was what you sat on. And there was one water tap, one shower, and one toilet for about 30 or 40 women. So you get up in the morning, 4 o'clock, and you get on one line for the toilet, and then you get on another line for the shower. It was really rough, but nobody seemed to mind in those days.
We were meditating in a tent on top of the building, and they'd set a tent up there. And so all of a sudden, this tremendous storm came. And it was a cloth tent, you know, they use for weddings and that type of thing. Wind started blowing, and it was really blowing. It was really raining. And the guys are all holding on to the ropes on the corner of the tent. And the wind's blowing the tent up. And they're pulling it down. And they're pulling it up. They're pulling it down. And it was so crazy. I mean, it finally got so heavy from the rain because it didn't have any weatherproofing on it, like canvas did, you know. And it just collapsed. And everybody's stuff was underneath. And oh my gosh, you know.
The tent was gone, but here's Goenkaji at 6 a.m. chanting on the Dhamma seat with Mataji. So that was very inspiring to see that the Dhamma wasn't going to get blown away. That you could remove the tent, but Goenkaji was still there and he wasn't going to stop teaching. So they scrambled and put the tent back up, and we continued on.
प्रतापगढ़ वहाँ देखा कि उन्होंने बनाया आश्रम, मगर वो कच्चा था एकदम, छत जो था ना पक्का पूरे सूखा भी नहीं था, ऐसे लकड़ी जोड़ के उसके ऊपर ईंटा रख के ऐसे करके बनाया था। मैंने देखा धम्मा हॉल, मुझे तो डर से लगा। फिर मैंने गुरुजी को जाके कहा, गुरुजी वो धम्मा हॉल तो मुझे ठीक नहीं लग रहा है, तो आप जाकर देख ले तो अच्छा हुआ। उन्होंने देखा, बोला नहीं होगा, खेत में मट्टी उट्टी तोड़ के खेत जमीन था उसका, वहाँ पर बनाया धम्मा हॉल। गुरुजी के लिए एक बक्सा, बक्से में कपड़ा बिछा के ऐसा करके गुरु जी उसमें बैठे, तो इस तरह वो कोर्स पूरा हुआ।
The course was held in a building site, a multi-story building site in Calcutta, where it was an incomplete high-rise building with the concrete floors and the some of the walls. And just covered in concrete dust, and the people there had just finished, were just finishing sitting 10 days with Goenkaji, and the people we were meeting, who were old students, came out covered in concrete dust on day 10, having just had metta. And the food was sort of in some sort of open area on the ground floor, and it was quite incredible. Yes.
शुरू शुरू में उन्होंने इतना कष्ट भोगा, उन्होंने कुछ रहने का ठिकाना नहीं, बाथरूम का नहीं, फिर भी वो अदम्य उत्साह से काम करते थे। जैसे बद्रेसर का शिविर हुआ, और पहले दिन हमने ये ख्याल नहीं किया, उनको जो कमरा दिया था और उतरने के लिए पगती नहीं थी, तो हमने पत्थर रखे थे जिस पर गुरु जी पैर रखकर नीचे उतरे ग्राउंड पर, तो वो पत्थर ऐसा हो गया और गुरु जी को फ्रैक्चर हो गया। पहले ही दिन ऐसा हुआ, हम लोग तो घबराए, अभी बुलाए इनको, पत्थर अभी फ्रैक्चर हो गया है, अभी आनापान कैसे देंगे और मुंह कैसे बताएंगे। पर गुरुजी के मुंह पर जरा सा भी वो नहीं, वो तो बिल्कुल आए लकड़ी में लेकर, पहले इनको ले जाने वाले थे वो प्लास्टर के लिए, पर उसके पहले मैं इनको आनापान दे दूँ, तो उस पीड़ा में वो लकड़ी लेकर लंगड़ाते लंगड़ाते आए, हॉल में आए और एकदम हाँ 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 हा करके हंसने लगे, और हम लोगों को पीड़ा में आनापान देकर घुस गए और प्लास्टर लगा गया।
उस जमाने ग्रीन कलर के बिस्तर टाइप के आते थे, एक तरफ में तकिया और एक तरफ में कम्बल, और नीचे पतला सा बिस्तर लगा के लपेट के, उसको बिंटा बोलते थे, वो बंद करके वो ट्रेन में घूमते रहते थे। जब माता जी नहीं आई तब तक थर्ड क्लास में ट्रेवलिंग करते थे पूरा, मतलब आप सोचिए 2 बरस तक थर्ड क्लास में ट्रेवलिंग किया।
उनके रास्ते चले गए, उनको तो सब चीज से जूझना पड़ेगा, उसको तो शराब शराब सब आएगा, एक तरफ कुछ तकलीफ आ रही है, एक तरफ अपने आप से शांति होता था, दोनों बात चली गई, सहने की भी ताकत मिलती थी।
The absence of proper screening of students meant that the organizers were unprepared for emotional outbursts of the students by the surgical cleansing of the mind induced by Dhamma. Yet, with profound metta and deep equanimity, Goenkaji used to face these challenges successfully.
Ningarki, वो मुस्लिम मस्जिद की सी भी थी, एक हमारा रिश्तेदार कोई आया था, वो नागों की तपस्या करता था कुछ भी, उस जमीन में बैठा।
ऐसा वो नाग बन के आया, कितना दूर से चल के ऐसे नाग अपना सिर को फन मारता है, ऐसे पांव करते जाने अभी क्या करेगा ये, ऐसा सिर्फ जमीन को मारता करता। फिर वो मस्जिद के ऊपर चढ़ गया, कभी कुछ किया कभी कुछ किया, और पत्थर उठाएगा तुम लोग को मारूंगा, ये करूंगा वो करूंगा।
गुरु जी बिल्कुल वहाँ से बस मैत्री करते थे, घबराते नहीं, तो नीचे आएगा इतना बड़ा पत्थर उठाकर उनको गुरु जी के ऊपर, मैं तुम्हारे ऊपर पत्थर डालकर अभी कुचल रहा हूँ, मारने वाला हूँ। और गुरु जी एकदम निर्भय, तो उसका पत्थर ऐसे गिर जाता।
I was sitting two or three rows back on the aisle, and I was meditating with eyes closed, listening to the discourse, and gradually became aware of some vibrations in the ground behind me and the feel of footsteps. And I saw that a male student was marching down the aisle, waving his arms and shouting. He started to shout. He was shouting to Gwenkji, you're talking about suffering. Look at all these people suffering because of you. and he carried on, and he went right. He approached the Dharma seat very closely, and the course managers leapt up, tried to do something, but no, he wouldn't stop. And Gwenkji and Mataji just smiled benevolently, and Gwenkji indicated for him just to sit down. No, he wouldn't stop. Eventually, he turned around, walked out. The story doesn't end there. Because during this course, a Dharma colleague of ours was recording the discourses. He found that he could splice the tape at the point where this tirade began and at the point where it left, and he joined the tape together, and Gwenkji's discourses rolled on without any, completely imperceptible break. So Gwenkji, after all that upheaval and commotion, had just carried on the discourse. And
उस समय उपद्रव बहुत होते, हर एक शिविर में कोई धुनने वाला, कोई चिल्लाने वाला ऐसा रहता था। तो बाद में हमने गुरुजी को पूछा, जब गुरुजी पहले ऐसा क्यों होता था, अब क्यों नहीं होता है? गुरुजी ने कहा, जब मैं इस देश में आया ना, शुद्ध धर्म का तरंग नहीं था, जहाँ देखो वहाँ अशुद्ध तरंग थे, और ऐसे मेली विद्या लेकर लोग आते थे। तो गुरुजी आपको कितना स्ट्रेन पड़ा होगा? अरे मुझे स्ट्रेन तो थी, मेरा गुरु उबाकिन वहाँ बैठा था ना, वो मुझे सहायता करता था।
Goenkaji was visionary in allowing flexibility in the code of conduct in the initial years to accommodate the conditions of those times.
Second day, fourth day, or sixth day, Montakali.
Silent days meant no talking, but writing notes was okay, gestures was okay. So we were fully communicating, we just weren't talking.
उस courses में segregation का भी इतना नहीं था जितना अब है, मतलब महिला पुरुष एक दूसरे को मिल सकते थे।
तो उस वक्त 80 रुपए 10 दिन के कोर्स का भोजन का चार्ज होता था, सिखाने का चार्ज नहीं था।
All of a sudden I see one man walking from room to room. Outside he was in the Burmese Viha. And I said, what is he doing? I asked them. They said, oh, he doesn't have the 30 rupees. So he's asking for money to be able to pay the course. And then I heard that next courses, they had changed the system. And instead of having people walk and ask for donations, in the table where you make the, where you inscribe yourself for the course and where you pay the money for the course, they had a bowl with money. And all you needed to do is just take money from the bowl and finish paying. I went there to pay, and all of a sudden I see Guruji's name, who also paid 30 rupees, as if he, who being the teacher, was paying his part.
Due to the lack of proper facilities to implement the code of conduct fully, Koyinkaji was lenient with the students.
And we used to walk down to the gate and get by chiki at the gate.
And peanuts.
And peanuts. Maybe it sent somebody down to get gulab jamun at the market. One time I came back, I was walking back to my room and Goenkaji was walking down on his morning walk with Jutla. And I had my head down in the bag behind my back. We were feeling very guilty. And Jutla looked at me and said, any question? And I went, no. Just walked on.
When I come back into my room, it's like 9:30, 9:45 at night, and I see these young Hindi guys getting dressed. No clean kurta. I said, where are you going? He goes, we're going to cinema.
Hamare ghar se 10-15 jane shaam ko aa jaate the milne ke liye aur khana wana lekar ke. Puri picnic jaise hoti thi.
Well, it was one of the wilder courses that probably ever happened in the history of Goenka's teachings, I'm sure, because, I mean, there were a lot of crazy things in those days, because there was a wedding, this woman from California. And anyway, they decided to get married, and they got married, and all of the women on the course, all the Indian women, they got this beautiful sari for her, and they dressed her all up. The Indian men, they got him all dressed up, and he had a turban and this fancy white pajama pants, and then there was a couple of the other students that were taking the course. They also were all dressed up, and they, in the middle of the course, like on day five or six, they all went out to this Hindu temple.
But Guruji was so relaxed. You know, he had all these, you know, hippie type Westerners. Yet, you know, it was just all part of, you know, they shouldn't be doing that. And, you know, it was such a relaxed atmosphere. And he was just walking around at times.
After a course, I remember in the middle of, I guess, a long course that I was sitting, I all of a sudden started remembering all of these things that we used to do, and I was mortified. I was just so embarrassed, and I went running to Goenkaji, and I said, I'm really sorry, Goenkaji. I'm really, really sorry that we were just so bad. And he just laughed. He said, look, if I was as strict with you then as I am now, you wouldn't be here.
In spite of disturbances, the results were stunning. More and more new students were joining the courses, and many old students were repeating the courses, providing conducive atmosphere for meditating to the new students. In addition to the direct benefits received from the practice of Vipassana, Goenkaji's exemplary conduct and magnetic personality became a lure for them.
तो हिल पे चढ़ रहे थे. मेरे पास एक प्लास्टिक का थैला था जिसमें मेरा एक शर्ट और पजामा था. तो ऊपर चढ़ रहे हैं, पैदल ही चढ़ रहे हैं. तो गुरुजी ने कहा, अरुण तुम्हारी तबीयत ठीक नहीं है, तो थैला मेरे को दे. बाद में समझ में आया कि ये हर एक को गुरुजी उसी तरह से व्यवहार उनका रहा हमेशा.
I was asked to meet him at the train station in Patanka. He was coming up to Dalhousie, so I go down in the taxi the night before and just waiting for his train. The train comes. He wants his tickets going back to Bombay. So he wouldn't have to deal with this later on. So he tells Mataji and I to just wait in the cab, and he went and stood in line for an hour at the Patanko train station, trying to get tickets. He couldn't get them. He said he came back smiling. He said, "Never mind."
अहमदाबाद में शिविर लगा गुरुजी का 1972 में, जबकि मेरी उम्र थी 11 साल. लगभग 150 के करीब साधक थे और तीन चार ऐसे थे मेरी उम्र के. और गुरुजी हमको बुलाते थे, कभी कभी वो हमको स्टोरी भी सुनाते थे. गुरुजी खुद स्टोरी सुनाते थे. और वो शिविर जब पूरा हुआ तो मुझे बिल्कुल ही, मतलब, घर जाने को मन नहीं हो रहा था. ऐसा ही लग रहा था कि ये शिविर और लंबा चले.
Well, Goenkaji wasn't a guru who had a group of students around him, and wherever he went, he would arrive just as the course started, and then he would just disappear at the end of the course. And he would travel, he was alone, or maybe traveling with Yadav, or later on with Mataji, but he never had a cadre of students following him around. So he was very detached, always. When he was on the Dhamma seat, and if you had questions and were wanted to learn Dhamma, he had unlimited amount of time for you, but he had no time for gossip.
He was a man of principles. Principles ko kabhi compromise nahi kiya. Auditorium mein pravachan chal raha tha. Then a message was sent by the chief minister ki he would like to meet Guruji. अगर वो रेजिडेंस पे आ सकें तो गुरुजी ने कहा भाई धर्म गुरु राजा के घर पे नहीं जाता है. तो मैंने कहा फिर क्या उपाय हो? उन्होंने कहा थर्ड प्लेस पे ऑर्गेनाइज कर सकते हो.
हाँ, अजमेर में एक अजमेर निवासी व्यक्ति गुरुजी से पत्राचार किया कि हमारे यहाँ भी एक शिविर लगना चाहिए. अजमेर जिले के एक तीर्थस्थल पुष्कर में एक धर्मशाला खोजी, लेकिन शिविर में बैठने वाला अजमेर का एक भी साधक नहीं मिला. हम लोग जब यात्रा के लिए निकले, हमारे सामने की सीट पर एक सन्यासी बैठे थे, स्वामी अखंडानंद उनका नाम. क्या आप कोई साधना वधना करते हैं क्या? तो गुरुजी ने कहा हाँ, मैं साधना करता हूँ और साधना सिखाता भी हूँ. कल से पुष्कर में एक शिविर लग रहा है, आप चलना चाहो तो मेरे साथ चलो. शिविर अच्छा हुआ, व्यवस्थापक जो थे वो स्वयं केवल 7 ही दिन ठहरे. उनको कोई मीटिंग के लिए जाना था, रह गए सिर्फ सन्यासी, मैं और गुरुजी, 3 आदमी.
33 गुरुजी,
9 आदमी की शिविर थी तो 9 आदमी की शिविर ले हुए
गुरुजी. ऐसा कि 100 चाहिए कि 200 चाहिए कि नहीं, जितना है इतना बैठो, मेरे पास है वो मैं आपको भी दूंगा. जो बड़ा गुरु होता है इतना सिंपल होता है, मैंने तो किधर नहीं देखा. आई हैव नॉट सीन.
Goenkaji was tirelessly sowing the seeds of Dhamma and they were bearing ample fruits. To supplement Goenkaji's efforts, old students started the publication of Vipassana Patrika, a monthly newsletter in Hindi in 1971. And International Vipassana Newsletter in 1974 to connect the students across the globe. The courses were evolving and students were getting more ardent about the practice, thus providing ideal conditions for serious meditation and spread of Dhamma.
Bhagwan batate aao bhikshu aur bhikshu ho jaate the. Phir Bhagwan ne 220 bhikshu ke niyam banaye dheere jaise jarurat. तो यहाँ जैसे जैसे धर्म एस्टैब्लिश होता गया, वैसे वैसे गुरुजी ने थोड़े थोड़े नियम, जैसे माउंट का नियम पहले नहीं था, फिर माउंट का नियम स्ट्रिक्ट कर दिया गया, सिंगल एकोमोडेशन का प्रेफरेंस दिया, फिर मेल फीमेल का सेग्रीगेशन तो पहले से ही था तो अभी बहुत टाइट बना दिया. तो इसी प्रकार का धीरे धीरे करके मॉडल सेंटर कैसे होना चाहिए ये निर्माण हुआ.